CRP is a program to take land out of crop production and turn it into native prairie, typically. What I do is come out and offer technical guidance on designing your CRP, how to get it established, how to manage it, how to evaluate the stand once you've already seeded it. CRP is a program that's jointly run with FSA and NRCS. And so NRCS was consulted on the seed mix, original seed mix, and establishment and management. The Soil and Water Conservation District was also involved, adding additional seed, and eventually they became the main managers of the property. They also got a grant from the PCA to diversify the seed mix and add more seed. This CRP was first established in 2000. This is a really highly diverse mix, and the point is to create wildlife habitat for pollinators, for birds and other animals, honeybees, and just to provide a little refuge and recreation area. Right now, I would say it's at least 50-50 with wildflowers to grasses. And they're not just grasses, they're sedges. There's just a whole diversity of grasses that fit every kind of niche. So cool season, warm season, sedges. This is a pretty poorly drained site. And so a lot of the species here favor wet soils. And so you can see that there's a diversity of species here with maybe 10 to 20 different flowering species that are flowering in any given season. So in spring there might have been 10 species blooming, now there's probably 20 species blooming, and in the fall I expect to see another 10 to 15 species blooming. And so that has inherent value for all kinds of wildlife, especially insects. Some CRPs, when you first get them established, they'll be dominated by one or two flowering species. Often it's black-eyed Susans or things that are short-lived perennials that bloom right away in the first 2 years, and it'll look like the whole landscape is dominated by that. But what you want is a seed mix that's going to have species that will come up in the 5 years, 10 years after that. So this is a mix that has longevity, because it has species that probably showed up in the first 5 years and probably petered out. You probably won't see them here anymore. But then there are species now that kind of supplanted those and will be here for the long term. And so with routine management, you'll get kind of this climax diversity within the prairie. So this is a mature one. This has a lot more diversity than you're gonna see in the first couple years. When you have a CRP that's dominated by one or two flowering species, there are only certain pollinators that can use those flowers. Certainly generalist pollinators like honeybees and bumblebees can use those flowers during the time that it's blooming, but when it's done blooming, then there's an absence of resources. And here we have species blooming from May through October, and you've got some generalist species like honeybees. This is a great environment for honeybees, but it also supports really specialist butterflies and pollinators that really only come out, they're only flying for maybe a few weeks at a time, and they rely, they're completely dependent on one species of flower or one genus of flower, and they need those resources. Maybe it's from the sunflower family. And so they're only flying during that period. And if you don't have those flowers in your CRP, then you're not going to support those pollinators. So the greater diversity of plants you have, the greater diversity of pollinators and beneficial insects. Let's see, we've got some gray-headed coneflower here and some flower beetles visiting, maybe eating a little pollen on the way. We've got lots of bee balm in here. This is for bees that have long tongues, like bumblebees. Honeybees can also use it. It's got superfood properties for bumblebees. Here's a little helictus. It's called a sweat bee. It's got lots of pollen on its on its legs there. So she'll take that back to her nest and feed that to her young. It's important to put milkweed in your seed mix because then you'll attract monarchs both for the flower, which creates nectar, and also for host plants for the monarch caterpillars. We need lots of different milkweed in the landscape if we're gonna increase the monarch population that's traveling down to Mexico. And this is kind of a fun, exotic looking prairie species. This is called Rattlesnake Master. It's native to southeastern Minnesota. And these are all soldier beetles, which are just starting to come out for the season. They're flower visiting, they eat some pollen and nectar. Their larval stages they're predaceous, so they'll eat other pest insects. This is Big Bluestem, and this is a shorter Big Bluestem, but this is what the flower will look like. These ones are gonna get 2 feet taller with one of these flowers at the top. They can get 4 feet to 8 feet tall. And in the fall, they're really beautiful. They're named Big Bluestem because they'll turn into this amber blue color that's just gorgeous. This is called Culver's Root. Popular with, there's a honeybee on here. There's some native bees. There's some beetles. Lots of different flies, obviously highly attractive to an assortment of insects. This is called compass plant. This is a relatively short individual, but sometimes they can get quite tall. They have this sunflower-like flower called compass plant because it kind of orients in the direction of the sun. It'll bloom. You can see it's going to have a long bloom time. All of these will be blooms. And it's super attractive to bees, to butterflies. And then it also creates these big seeds that birds like to eat. All around me there's goldenrod that isn't doing much right now except for just getting taller and taller, but its time to shine is gonna be in a month or two. And then it will be the dominant color around here. Lots of different species of goldenrod too, not just your common Canada goldenrod. I've got showy goldenrod here, Canada goldenrod. There's some stiff goldenrod I saw. There are a few goldenrods that are special, kind of unique to more wetter sites, wetland species. Goldenrod's really important for monarchs and for bumblebees and lots of other beneficial insects. So all grasslands need management. They wouldn't be grasslands without some kind of disturbance. So that's fire, that's grazing, that's haying. Without those kinds of disturbances, you're gonna get a woodland. And so typically we recommend different, kind of changing up the management. And never burning an entire site all at once, maybe burning one third of it, so that you're leaving some area for refuge for the insects that can't get away during a fire, and they can repopulate that burned area. But burning and haying and grazing are all great disturbances because they set back the invasive species that you don't want, and they promote the native species that were adapted to that kind of regime, that disturbance regime. Pollinators have been in decline, serious decline, for the last couple decades. Honeybees kind of drew our attention to it, but we're realizing that bumblebees and all kinds of butterflies and other wild pollinators are really threatened. And CRP, among other NRCS or Farm Bill programs, offers a really great opportunity to provide habitat within the agricultural matrix where we really need habitat. This particular CRP is supporting a vast diversity of pollinators. I see honeybees all over the place. I see little sweat bees, and I've already seen 5 different kinds of bumblebees this morning. We have lots of different butterflies. I've seen beetles. Beetles are sometimes pollinators. There are hoverflies, which are another kind of pollinator, but also a beneficial insect in its larval stage. So many different types of pollinators out here. Some that are only specialist on these flowers, but some that would also be important crop pollinators if this were adjacent to a vegetable field, for example. Oh, there's a lot of diversity here. Yeah.